Hi, and welcome back to Tech Talk. I'm Ken Mingis, Executive Editor at Computerworld. I'm here with Lucas Mearian, Senior Writer for Computerworld. If you're watching us on LinkedIn Live or YouTube, we're broadcasting live. So if you've got questions for us, please leave them in the comments. We'll try to answer them while we're talking about blockchain. That's today's hot topic. And as always, please play nice. No food fights in the comments section. So Lucas, thanks for being here.
Sure.
As always, it's important to sort of check in with blockchain because it's sort of evolving so quickly these days that it's hard to keep track of who's doing what, who's got proofs of concept. Yeah, pilot projects, things like that. You had a really interesting story yesterday that sort of takes a look at how Gartner views blockchain right now. And despite all the hype, it seems like they've been a bit cautious about embracing the blockchain's going to change the world. So what is Gartner saying, and what should companies be aware of these days?
So right now, blockchain, after a lot of hype, is sort of slipping into the trough of disillusionment.
I love the trough of disillusionment. I think of it as the trough of despair.
Sea of despair, yes. Yeah. Which just means that people's expectations are becoming more realistic, and they're backing off a little more. They're being a little more serious and judicious about how they deploy it in their POCs and pilots. So it's not a bad thing. It's kind of a settling of the technology, of view of the technology.
Yeah, I mean, it is interesting. Basically, for those who aren't aware, blockchain is a distributed ledger technology that's been really rolled out, I guess, in a couple places for sure, is financial services and supply chains as a way to basically tie together a lot of business processes that may be archaic at this point, paperwork, things like that. Yeah. It's gone through quite a bit of hype for the last couple of years, including predictions that it would be as disruptive as the internet was 20 years ago. That said, as a lot of companies start trying out these different forms of blockchain or blockchain as a service, they're finding out that, first of all, it doesn't necessarily solve the business processes they wanted to update and modernize. And secondly, and this comes from your story about Gartner, that there's been a fair amount of fragmentation. So what's Gartner talking about there with the fragmentation issue?
So there are no standards right now. Okay. There are possible de facto standards emerging, but we don't know for sure in 5 years if they will become the standards, or even in 2 years if they'll be de facto standards. So you have to be cautious about that. There are a lot of different forms. There's R3/4, Hyperledger, Ethereum, half a dozen others, and then there are subsets of each of those. So there's a lot of different versions of blockchain platforms. They don't always play together well. They don't talk to each other.
Because they're almost just different approaches to the same basic technology.
Exactly.
In other words.
Okay. Exactly. So let's say I am a huge grocer, and I have a lot of different suppliers for my stores. If all of them are on one platform, that's great. We can all talk. But what if they adopt others? Or what if you bring on new suppliers who have a different version of blockchain? Now you're having to support different versions of blockchain that all have to link it back to your internal systems. They don't talk to each other. There's no standards for that.
So that's going to make it almost impossible for a company. I mean, you've got something that reminds me of Walmart, which is has begun to embrace blockchain. Isn't this the month that they've told their suppliers they have to be on their system so that they can basically track food from farm to table? If you're just tuning in, we're talking about blockchain. Just let you know that we're kind of getting an update from Lucas Mearian here about where it is right now. After a few years of hype, things seem to be settling down, and so we're trying to figure out where it goes now. So Gartner, back to the fragmentation. It was interesting too, though, that one of the points that you made in your story, based on the Gartner report, was that with all these companies experimenting and spending some serious money to try to figure out how to make it work for them, they need to realize that whatever flavor of blockchain they're using right now may not win out. They may be spending money on something that in 2 or 3 years will have fallen by the wayside.
Right.
And what's Gartner's view on how that's going to shake out?
They're telling, in terms of the long-term standards that may emerge, so consortiums, industry groups like the IEEE will probably eventually, not that one in particular, but like that, will probably eventually be responsible for developing a standard that will be adopted by the industry. It won't be government regulators who insist on a standard, although they may work with them. Mm-hmm. And no industry groups have really gelled together yet to create a standard. This is all so nascent that they're still experimenting with it. They're seeing how companies are trying to adopt it and use it. Not necessarily a bad thing for big companies to experiment with it, but don't put a lot of resources into this. If you want to play with it a little, you want to use a blockchain service, companies like IBM, SAP, Oracle, they all provide SaaS services.
It's basically almost like a blockchain in a box. It gives you a chance. Exactly. It gives you a platform. They come in, here's the platform. You can kind of experiment, see how it ties into your business right. processes without really investing a lot of money up front.
You don't need a blockchain developer. You don't need to purchase a bunch of hardware nodes to create that ledger. So yeah, it is like blockchain in a box. But they're saying be careful. And Gartner's not the only one. Forrester is also very conservative about blockchain. They're concerned, as Gartner is, that whatever pans out in the end is not going to be what you're trying to roll out now. Mm-hmm. Blockchain has a lot of potential, but we're not going to see what that potential truly is until standards develop.
Yeah, it is interesting, too. You kind of wonder, since governments have really kind of backed off on this, I mean, I know China's looking at it as perhaps using blockchain as a part of a fiat currency.
Fiat currency system, and it's actually, in ways you could say, they're weaponizing it. Yeah. Because, as you know, there's a trade war going on with the United States right now, and that's based on what is the de facto currency, which is the U.S. dollar
yep.
in the business world. Well, if they create another de facto currency, i.e. cryptocurrency, they can undermine any efforts by us to usurp their power in that trade
Interesting.
War.
That would be a huge deal if you could displace the U.S. dollar as the currency
exactly.
for global trade.
And I think
trade.
That's what a lot of these countries are thinking. I can't read their minds, but it seems like that's what they're thinking. They're thinking this is a kind of a power grab situation where they can control a cryptocurrency in a way that they couldn't control Bitcoin, because China has basically shut down a lot of Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. They don't want these mining farms in their country. They don't trust it. But if they can control it, that's a whole different situation.
Yeah, I never thought about blockchain as a weapon. If you're just tuning in, we're talking about blockchain, which has been hyped for the last couple of years. We're trying to figure out where it's going now, and there seems to be some cautionary tales out there. Interesting, you know, one story that you're working on now that I know you haven't written up yet, but as companies like Facebook and others are kind of coming up with these their own cryptocurrencies and their crypto wallets, I mean, you know, Apple's sort of thinking about blockchain now. There are some things bubbling up in Europe that could be problematic for, like, Facebook. What's going on there?
Well, as people have kept up with the news knows, Facebook has had some privacy concerns over the past few years.
One or two along the way.
And they've been taken to task for that, you know, whether alleged or actual. But, so France and Germany, when Facebook announced that they were planning to create their own cryptocurrencies.
This is Libre?
Libra.
Libra,
yeah.
Okay, Libra.
And it's a stable coin. So what's yep. a stable coin? A stable coin is a digital currency that's backed by a fiat currency like the U.S. dollar, like the euro. You know, like a peso, whatever currency you want.
It has something behind it that's real, as
exactly.
opposed to what everybody thinks it's worth.
Exactly. So there's an actual value behind it. It's tied to it. J.P. Morgan Chase came out with JPM coin mm-hmm. Earlier this year as a method of using blockchain to make cross-border transfers. And that money is tied back to whatever currency in that continent.
The local
originates.
Currency?
Exactly. Yeah. So... France and Germany's finance ministers came out in a joint statement and said, we are not going to support, we are going to block Facebook's Libra coin in these countries. Now, they can't speak for the entire EU, but they are basically platform
they're
countries.
They're pretty big players.
They're why the yeah. EU was created, more or less, and the UK is thinking about leaving. So.
Right.
Although they're the other powerhouse there, these are the two main countries that set the tone for a lot of the regulatory programs.
Right.
So they don't speak for the other 26 nations, or 25 if the UK's out.
Depending on the UK.
But they certainly have a vast amount of influence and could certainly kind of stem the tide.
Have we heard anything back from Facebook yet?
We haven't. No, I haven't heard.
Okay.
I don't know.
Waiting for you.
I don't know.
But not
what
for long.
What the upside is for them to comment at this point.
Yeah.
They may at some point.
They made a big splash when they announced this. And, you know, you do have to wonder if you've got nations like Germany and France. I mean, if they were to pull the whole EU into their view of this, and start throwing up some roadblocks, you know, you do have to wonder, because obviously one of the things about a cryptocurrency and a crypto wallet is the whole point of being global.
Right.
You know, you've got one sort of financial underpinning for everybody. And if you've got whole segments of you know, again, the EU, for instance, it says we're not interested or we think there are privacy issues here, what that would do to Facebook's plans.
Well, what's interesting is a lot of these cryptocurrencies are targeting the unbanked.
Yep.
So in developing nations or nations whose governments are in turmoil right now, like Venezuela, where the currency has been devalued extensively.
Yeah.
So they're targeting these countries, and they're for cross-border payments. So let's say that I am an immigrant working in the United States, and I want to send money home to Venezuela. Am I going to send it home in Venezuelan currency?
Which is rapidly declining.
Yeah. Or am I going to use a stable coin that's tied to the U.S. dollar to send it back home? I'm going to choose the stable coin. I mean, I would do that.
Yeah.
So that's their concern. Facebook has, what is it, 1.52 billion subscribers, insane number of people. And if a percentage of them, 100 million, 200 million, decide that they're going to get on this stablecoin wagon, this Libra wagon, they could really they could control the value of currency in those countries. They could actually impact the economics of those countries, because once you tie it to local currency, that currency is basically out of circulation.
Yeah.
Because it has to, as it's tied to the cryptocurrency, it's not being used unless the cryptocurrency is being spent. So it's in a type of digital wallet, let's say.
It's interesting because, you know, that goes back to the original point that, you know, the idea that blockchain-based, I guess, ledgers and or cryptocurrencies could be disruptive.
Yeah.
And that is an example of how this could be extremely disruptive to the financial services industry and just financial, you know, platforms across the world if it takes off.
Yeah. I mean, this could affect the central banks. This could affect organizations like SWIFT, which do the money transfers today.
Mm-hmm.
It could affect, government bodies like the Federal Reserves of these nations, because the Federal Reserve's business is to create stability in currency in those nations, the local currencies. Well, now suddenly Facebook becomes a sort of de facto Federal Reserve if they're holding 10% of the local currency.
So. Yeah.
So
they become a bank.
Yeah,
in
developing
ways.
Countries. They absolutely become a bank.
Okay, good. Yeah. Any questions real quick before we go?
Yeah, we've got a few questions here. One is maybe basic for Lucas, but they're asking, how secure is blockchain compared to other methods? I'm not sure what they mean by methods.
Blockchain itself is extremely secure.
That's what makes it so popular.
That is what makes it so popular. It's based on cryptography. It cannot, you literally cannot change something once it's placed in that ledger. However, this is the caveat, blockchain doesn't sit by itself. It has applications that are built on top of it. Bitcoin is an application on top of a blockchain or a distributed ledger. That does create a security issue. Can create a security issue. I don't say it does. It can create a security issue. And we've seen people hack Bitcoin before. Bitcoin.
They can
networks.
Manipulate the system, basically.
Absolutely.
While the blockchain underneath it may be secure, the Bitcoin on top can be manipulated depending on who's got how many Bitcoin and what they're doing with it.
For example, you know, there are several methods of creating a consensus, but the most popular one is called proof of work. And basically, you have a lot of nodes and computers that have to work out a mathematical problem, and once they work out that mathematical problem, they are able to add data. Let's take out the cryptocurrency equation. Just say data to the network, and that is immutable. Once it's entered into the network,
it cannot be changed.
Right. That remains. However, if you can grab a majority of those nodes, you can control what data is added to that network. So it's called. They call it a 51% attack. So that just means more than 50% of the nodes are now controlled by one entity. Now
and they're steering that data or lack of data in a certain direction that's going to be beneficial to
them. They can change. They can actually change the network. However, we have to remember this is typically done on smaller blockchains where there aren't as many nodes, blockchain networks. You're not going to see that with a large Bitcoin network. It's because you'd have to expend
too
much
many
power.
People. Yeah, you wouldn't
too
be
much
able to
money.
Just do it.
It wouldn't be worth your time.
Right. Got it. Okay.
Yeah. Another one, they're asking about standardization. So isn't IBM already working to standardize the blockchain along with other companies and universities?
Hyperledger Fabric. Yes, that's an example of what could become a de facto standard. It's certainly being tested by a lot of industries. You have the diamond industry, you have the produce industry with Walmart that is testing it on food chain. You have TradeLens that is being tested, also another Hyperledger-based platform from IBM that's being tested by shipping companies like Maersk and a lot of their partners. It's being tested. It has a good chance of becoming a de facto standard, but there's no guarantee that it will be.
Right.
And Gartner believes that it'll be about 1 to 2 years before these de facto standards actually start to gel, where there's enough users behind them where they become that de facto standard. But there's no guarantee of that. And in 3 to 5 years, they're saying, is a possibility that industry standards may emerge, you know, beyond the de facto standards.
Yeah, that's why the big rush for all of these companies to jump in. They're hoping to create the one, as IBM is, that
gotcha.
Will be the standard.
Exactly.
Yeah. So that, and then the last question I had here was, where do you see this technology 2 years from now? You kind of just answered that.
Yeah,
I think they're going to work on securing it. I think you're going to see new consensus mechanisms. You're going to see hybrid blockchains coming out, which is basically
public and private.
Yeah. There are advantages to both. And what we've already talked about, which is the formation of some de facto standards.
Yeah, the best way to find out is check back in 2 years, because we'll still have Lucas here.
We'll let you know
where it goes.
I'll be right here with some cobwebs.
Exactly. No, you won't. No cobwebs.
No.
That's great. Great questions. Very much appreciated that you're asking about that. That's to the core of what we're talking
about.
Yeah,
absolutely. Good questions.
So, yeah. Lucas, thank you. Any last thoughts before I let you go?
Look for the story tomorrow.
Okay, yes, exactly. We're working on a story for Computer World about this whole issue with Facebook, Libra,
and the European Union.
The European
and
Union.
Other countries.
Yeah, what might be happening
there. Have been some U.S. congressmen who have voiced similar concerns. So.
Okay, yeah, coming up on this side of the pond as well. So thank you for being here, Lucas.
Absolutely.
Just a quick reminder that in terms of our LinkedIn Live broadcast and our YouTube broadcast, you can always subscribe to the YouTube channel. You can follow our Computer World LinkedIn page if you want to see future tech talks. And in fact, we have one coming up next week. We're going to have Windows guru Preston Growlin. We'll be back to answer your Windows 10 questions. You don't want to miss that. So stick around, watch us. Appreciate you watching us today, and we'll see you next week.